now I think we'll kind of open it up a little bit more to the question and answer period, because I'm going to point out a few issues here that I think everybody who has a multinational family needs to be aware of. And when I say multinational family, what I mean is families that have multiple citizenships, families that have multiple places of residency, family that have assets in multiple places. You have to take all these things into consideration, because, you know, every country of which they're a citizen, they're subject to those countries' laws. Every country of which they're a resident, they're subject to those countries' laws. And every country in which they have assets, they're subject to those countries' laws. And all that stuff needs to somehow be accounted for and planned for. So the purpose, obviously, of estate planning, first and foremost, is to ensure that the estate goes to the intended heirs. You want the people that you want to leave it to actually receive it. The second purpose of estate planning is to reduce or eliminate estate taxes, if possible. And what makes that really difficult is, for multinational families, is the different types of legal systems. Because the US, for example, is a common law country. So, you know, we use a lot of trusts and things like that in estate planning. Whereas Europe is primarily civil law countries that don't really like trusts. Most of them have to recognize trusts because of the Hague Convention, but a lot of them don't like them and tax them fairly disfavorably. And a lot of them, you can't establish trusts in. They'll recognize it, a US trust, for example, but they won't let you set up a trust in their own jurisdiction. Then you have other countries that are Sharia law, like, you know, Dubai, where I live, or Jordan or Saudi Arabia, that don't recognize wills or trusts at all because they're Sharia law. And some countries, like the US, like I was saying earlier, tax based on citizenship, while others base it on residency or domicile. And this is a really, residency and domicile are two very different things, and they're both tricky concepts. Because residency is where you live right now, right? So if you're on, let's say, a job assignment in Amsterdam, then you would be a resident of the Netherlands. But it doesn't necessarily mean your domicile is there, because if you sign a 3-year work contract to come to the Netherlands, that means you're going to be a resident in the Netherlands for 3 years. But you're not domiciled here, because after the 3 years, you plan to maybe go back to the US, which means your domicile is the US. And so some countries say, well, if your domicile's here, so like the UK, for example, is one where even if you leave to go work somewhere and you're a resident of, let's say, the Netherlands, but you intend to go back to England, England will say, well, your domicile's still here, and so we're still going to tax your estate. So if you had, for example, a dual citizen between the US, the UK, who really lived in the UK and then went to Amsterdam, you already have the US because of citizenship, the UK because of domicile, and the Netherlands because of residency. And you have to try to figure all that out. Also, not all countries have gift and estate taxes. So that's another thing to look at. Australia, for example, they did away with estate taxes. And like we were saying before, some levy the tax on the person giving the gift or the estate, while others levy it on the recipient. Some countries have exemption amounts for gifts and inheritance to spouses and children, and others don't. So, you know, some, like I was saying, in the US, you have this marital deduction where US citizen spouses can give an unlimited amount of money between each other and inherit an unlimited amount between each other. Other countries don't. And then even between spouses, it's going to be taxed, or there's a limit to it. Some countries allow you to give a certain amount to your children tax-free. Others don't. So all that really needs to be analyzed. And another thing, and this is something we run into quite a bit, you have a lot of situations where you have an American woman who's married to a non-resident husband, and the husband was the major breadwinner, and the woman was mostly a homemaker, and most of the business assets and investments and things like that are in the husband's name. And especially if the husband's a business owner or has a large portfolio, if he dies and leaves his assets to either the wife or the children, or splits it up among them, they have to deal with whatever those assets are. So that means, for example, all of a sudden, all these assets that never had to be reported before on an FBAR or PFIC reporting or any of this other stuff, like owning foreign corporations and all this because it belonged to a non-resident, now is all gonna fall under the US tax debt. Meaning the investment account's gonna have to go on an FBAR, the ownership in the foreign corporation is gonna have to be reported, and there's certain types of income that are taxed very disfavorably in the US. So for example, foreign corporation income, it's subject to a GILTI tax, it's subject to a subpart F tax. If you own a PFIC, and PFICs are very common, I'm sure some of you are familiar with PFICs, they're basically foreign mutual funds, which a lot of Europeans own as pretty safe, you know, investment vehicles. But they're taxed horrendously by the US. And so most banks won't sell them to US citizens. But they can't do anything if now all of a sudden a US citizen inherits them. And then you have a bunch of reporting and tax problems. The other issue is those assets then become stuck in the U.S. heirs, in the U.S. heirs estate, right? So if you had, let's say, like the example I was giving, a non-resident spouse that built up a substantial amount of wealth that had nothing to do with the U.S., and all of a sudden U.S. people inherit it, what happens when those U.S. people die? The U.S. is going to levy a state, could potentially levy a state tax on these foreign assets that really have nothing to do with the United States, which is kind of unfair too. So that needs to be planned for. And then this is kind of the inverse of that, is what happens if a non-resident alien inherits U.S. assets? So what happens if it's the U.S. citizen spouse that dies and leaves assets to a non-resident alien spouse or non-resident alien children? Well, the U.S. would levy a state tax on any assets that were in the U.S. And so any U.S. assets is basically any asset physically located in the U.S. So real estate, cars, stocks and bonds, things like that. So there's no exclusion for gift tax. So for example, if you had a U.S. citizen spouse that owned a house in the U.S. and they wanted to gift that to their non-U.S. citizen child or their non-U.S. citizen spouse, the value of that gift is going to immediately start reducing the lifetime gift tax exclusion or be subject to gift tax if it's above it. And this is the really one of the really unfair parts, right? So we're talking about if you're a U.S. citizen, you have an $11.2 million estate tax exclusion. If you're a non-US citizen that owns US assets, you only get an exclusion of 60 grand. So if, for example, you had a US citizen spouse that had a house that's, let's say, worth $500,000, and they die, and leave that house to their non-citizen spouse, when that non-citizen spouse has to do something with that house, right? So either the non-citizen spouse, maybe he's going to gift it to his, to their kids, or own it until that spouse passes away, and then leave it to the kids. And only 60,000 of it will be free of tax. So on a $500,000 house, 440,000 of it's going to be subject to 40% estate tax. But you know, there are also things that American citizens with U.S. assets can do to help safeguard against this, which is use things like trusts, for example. Trusts are very valuable, and there's different kinds of trusts. There's irrevocable trusts and there's revocable trusts. But using a trust, for example, because what happens if you have, let's say, a house in California, right? And you have a U.S. citizen spouse that owns this house in California, you live in Switzerland, you have two underage kids who are Americans and a spouse that's Swiss that's not American. You don't want to leave a house in California to two underage kids. You can't even really do that. So you need this house to be managed at least by the non-citizen spouse. And by using a trust, you can do that because you can leave it to the American citizen kids, but put a trustee in place, which could be the non-resident spouse, that's going to manage it for the children. It gives them authority over to sell the house, to rent it out, to do whatever, but he doesn't own it, or she doesn't own it.
Same goes for
brokerage accounts. Absolutely. Yes?
If this is too specific, I can ask later. What if a non-American owning American assets?
Yeah.
Is there any way to, what's the best way to handle it?
So we normally recommend putting it in some type of entity. So, I mean, this is just, it depends on what the assets are. Okay, so I'll give you an example of a very common, and again, it depends on what country you're a resident of, okay? Because, what I would do in a situation like that is I would actually probably form a German GmbH, which is like a German corporation. And I would have the German corporation own the U.S. house.
What does that do?
Well, what that does is this. So the shares of the German corporation are not U.S. property. So the U.S. cannot levy estate tax on them, right? The house is U.S. property. So if the non-citizen owns a house in California and something happens to them, you have this estate tax problem where they're going to have to pay 40% tax on everything above $60,000. Or if they want to gift it, they have to pay 40% on the entire value. But the U.S. estate and gift taxes only apply to U.S. property. So U.S. property is U.S. stocks and bonds, U.S. real estate, and any asset physically located in the United States. If a foreigner owns a German company that owns U.S. real estate, what does the foreigner own? Shares of a German company. Shares of a German company are not U.S. property. They're German property. So if they own the shares, then there's no U.S. estate tax.
And the estate doesn't apply to the GmbH?
No.
But in the other session you had,
yeah.
It's owned by more than 50% American.
Yes.
Then you get still taxed.
Yes.
So you would have to put that in the name. The foreigner.
Yes. The question was if a foreigner. Yeah. The question was if a foreigner owned.
Yeah.
U.S. property.
Yeah, but that foreigner may have children who are Americans too. Right?
Yeah.
That's,
yes. So this is where the estate planning comes in. So. Let's say, for example, that the house in California right now belongs to an American, but they're going to leave it to a non-American. And that's where the potential problem comes in, is that when the non-American then wants to leave it, so let's do a case study. We have an American wife that owns a house in California who is married to a German, and they both live in Germany. The German husband has no green card, no dual nationality with the United States. And you have dual citizen underage kids. So, the wife owns this house, and just so we can use round numbers and make it easy, let's say the house is worth $1 million, okay? So, if the wife were to die and leave this to her husband, that can be done tax-free as long as because the million would reduce the $11.2 million estate tax exclusion to $10.2 million, there's no tax. Now we have this German husband that owns this house worth $1 million. Now he can't get rid of the house without paying gift or estate tax of 40%. If he wants to give it to his kids, he has to pay 40% gift tax, so $400,000. If he dies owning it, then there's 40% gift tax, 40% estate tax on $940,000, because we have that $60,000 estate tax exclusion for foreigners. So, the other option would be The mother could put it in a U.S. trust, as an example, naming her German husband the trustee, so he's the one that could control it, and naming the kids the beneficiaries. Now we've basically given control of the house to the husband, but we've bypassed him for ownership, and it goes directly into the kids' names, which also necessarily isn't, you know, a bad idea, because you can put in the trust that they don't get the money until they're 25 or 35 or 40 or whatever, which is, you know, beneficial to a lot of people like that. But it also somewhat limits the husband's access to the money from the house. So, you know, if the wife really wanted the husband to also have access to this money to be able to, like, sell it and use it to buy a car or something, or a boat, you know. But he could do that. He could really only use the house only for the benefit of the kids, which isn't always necessarily what people want. Another option, which would kind of allow you to have your cake and eat it too, but it's much more complicated, would be the example that I was giving with a foreign corporation, right? So in the US, a GmbH at least, and a lot of similar type corporations in a lot of countries like BB's in the Netherlands and stuff like that, you can choose how you want to have them taxed in the US, how the US will view them. You can either have them viewed as a foreign corporation, or you can have them viewed as tax transparent, like they don't exist. So in a situation like that, what I would do, I would have the American citizen spouse form a German GmbH that would own the house in California, and I would have them choose to have the GmbH taxed as if it did not exist. So this doesn't create these controlled foreign corporation problems with the 10% or more. You don't have this GILTI tax, you don't have subpart F tax. It's just, for tax purposes, it's as if she still owned the house by herself. I would then set it up so that upon her death, it automatically turned into being taxed as a foreign corporation. So when the husband receives it, he's receiving stock in the foreign corporation rather than the real estate. So I would have it triggered on death that it turns into a foreign corporation. So now he owns the foreign stock in the foreign corporation, and God forbid, if he dies, then he's just passing the stock in this foreign corporation. So the foreign corporation, if let's say the house was rented out, the foreign corporation would have to pay tax in the US on this. But now that the US lowered its corporate tax rate to 21%, you're cheaper paying corporate level tax rates than, you know, the highest individual tax rate of 37%. And then the husband could use those shares to leave them to his kids or do whatever he wanted to do. So there's a lot of options, but they're complicated. And the other part of it, especially like with Germany, is Germany taxes, like a lot of European countries, taxes the recipient of the gift or inheritance. So that makes it really tricky when you have the US who taxes the person giving the gift, and Germany who taxes the recipient. And so you really need two advisors that both understand the gift and estate tax treaty between Germany and the US to figure out how to do that so you don't get double taxed and wind up with nothing. Because I think Germany's estate tax is like 50% and the US's is 40%. You add that together, the governments are eating well. So those are a lot of things that need to be looked at.